obviously your horses have got a really long career by the sound of that. Like, how do you maintain their health while you're out and about on the road and also at home, like both general husbandry and nutrition?
We're pretty fortunate. We live in a buffalo belt here, like, so we've got you know, good country for cattle, but not so much so you know, the obviously you know, we balance here. We have our paddocks where the horses run. We heavily stock them with cattle at this time of year. Like before this, like you know, some 2 months ago, I've actually put big groups of cattle in there, and they knock the buffalo down, and you know, keep it so that the horses are coming home at 6 in the morning, 6 at night for dinner and breakfast, you know, and so they're supplemented obviously with feed and loose and hay and, you know, and a lot of other stuff. When they're not, we don't have them on the buffalo. Like our horses that we breed are off, you know, so there's some at Tamworth and some, you know, just north of Tamworth, and some at our in South Queensland that have no buffalo. So that's our program. But there's a lot of people that have been breeding horses very successful in this area, and they, you know, every year they have their lanes eaten down, and they look after it and they manage it. You know, I mean, it's like anything, you just got to manage it. Huh? That makes sense, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So what about out on the road? Like, what are you doing to maintain your horse's health? Like, obviously you would travel far and wide with your horses. What are you doing maintaining their health on the road as well? Like, we had a question from a gentleman, I can't quite remember his name there now, but he was asking about how do you look after your horses with long trips, and how do you keep them drinking as well?
Why we mentioned the traveling, when they start traveling when they're 3, so that's a reduce the stress, so that they shouldn't, the mental part shouldn't impact them, because I think they've got to I think that's a big thing. Pete doesn't go over 800 Ks, so we, you know, that just generally covers the young horses off, so that they're, you know, they're not on the truck or on the road for over 12 hours. Doesn't matter what happens, they're not traveling for over 12 hours. So we always give them a rest at some point, but we can usually do a 12-hour day without any trouble. We've had no trouble for years, thankfully. But stress is a big thing. The water, that's why we start traveling when they're 3. So, you know, they learn to drink like a dog, like a working dog. They're taught to drink it, or, you know, it's more of a mental stress type of thing. People put molasses, and yeah, there's different tricks to put in different sorts of water. You go out west and some of the water's got a smell and a taste to it. So, you know, often they've used molasses in the water. And oh, there's other lick blocks. Electrolytes is my go-to. I always just have electrolytes on us, because obviously they're driven to drink with that. But, yeah, they're probably our key things. Water's the biggest thing, and having on hand and hay. Like, we always have hay, make sure that every time they stop, they get a bit of hay and a bit of water.
That's an important thing, I suppose. Travelling horses is, common sense is the most important thing. You know, going south, I mean, out of our hot climate into a cool climate, if you're heading south, you can do, you know, a few more Ks. On our way back from those big events, we've got to be very careful, you know, just on a... coming into the heat and that sort of stuff, you know. So if you're coming home from Warwick, you know, at the end of October, obviously, you know, your temperatures rise so quickly and that sort of stuff. So you've got to be careful of the, you know, if you're coming back from Tamworth too in January, February, you know, when those big events on down there, obviously coming into the heat, you've got to be careful. So keeping those horses rehydrated and running the horses on and off just for an hour. I had a guy, I was feeding my horses on the truck going along, and you know, many years ago he told me that, you know, while they're eating or drinking, they've got to put their head on the ground. It was great advice, really. You know, I don't feed mine going along and that sort of stuff. I know some people do, but I think if you're going to do that sort of stuff, you need to put their, you know, they need to be in a situation where they can put their head right down to do your, you know, to digest the feed and that sort of thing, you know. But yeah, we've been very lucky over the years traveling, that sort of stuff. You know, just to, I suppose most of the time is sometimes you're better off just dropping them, you know, letting them off. I'll tell you, we're very fortunate to have cameras and that sort of stuff. If they start, you know, playing up a little bit and with boring and that sort of stuff, if you kick them off for an hour, sometimes it can be the easiest thing you can do, if that makes sense. Yeah.
We do have a few special ones that have to travel with their friends. There's things that silly.
Yeah. Sometimes, yeah, you know, that sort of stuff, yeah, you know, makes a big difference. Some of the questions there, people are saying, how do you get on traveling stallions? We find actually, if you put your stallions with their next to a gelding that they're used to, and put the stallions close to the other horses, they play up a lot less than treating them like a, you know, a lot of times with a horse, if you treat them like a tiger, they'll sort of act like one, if that makes sense, you know. So, you keep the stallions with the group and that sort of stuff, and keep them close to a gelding, you know, on both sides and that sort of stuff. So we've had very little trouble with travelling stallions over, you know, a long time, just because, I just try and keep them all together, if that makes sense, you know.